Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Ceylon College of Internal Medicine and the SLMA for providing me this opportunity to participate in this virtual symposium. For the next 20 to 25 minutes, I'm going to take you through three different clinical scenarios related to hypertension and on altered mental state. The first case scenario is a 47-year-old man with a 2-month history of progressive headache presented to the emergency department with nausea, vomiting, visual disturbance, and confusion for a day. He denied fever, weakness, numbness, shortness of breath, and flu-like symptoms or symptoms suggestive of encephalitis. And he had significant medical history of hypertension and was on amlodipine 5 milligram daily in the past. But a year ago, he stopped taking medication due to an unspecified reason. The patient denied any history of smoking, alcoholism, and recreational drug use, but had a significant family history of hypertension in both his father and mother. His physical examination was unremarkable, except his blood pressure was very high, 195 by 123, and it's equal in both arms. The patient was promptly started on intravenous labetalol with a goal to reduce the blood pressure by 15 to 20% in the first hour. The blood pressure rechecked, and after an hour of starting labetalol, and the target was achieved by 1 hour time. 165 and 100 value was obtained. His initial ward investigations revealed nothing remarkable except raised serum creatinine. Left ventricular hypertrophy was noticed on the ECG, and the urine showed a proteinuria. The initial CT scan was arranged to rule out any intracranial events like a stroke, and that showed a typical picture of a occipital lobe hypodensitivity, and that was symmetrical, so that is not in favor of stroke. So the radiologist requested an MRI brain. So the presumptive diagnosis was made as PRESS, that is a progressive reversible encephalopathy syndrome on CT brain. The MRI of the brain demonstrated multiple scattered areas of increased signal intensity on T2 weighted and fluid attenuated inversion recovery flare images in both occipital and posterior parietal lobes. There were also similar lesions in both hemispheres of the cerebellum, especially the cerebellar white matter on the left, as well as in the medulla oblongata. The lesions were not associated with mass effect, and after contrast administration, there is no evidence of abnormal enhancement. These are the images of MRI images that typically shows fluid attenuated inversion recovery images showing that hyperdensities in the cortex and subcortical white matter of right parietal occipital lobe, consistent with posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. We move to the second case scenario, a 35-year-old man, previously in good health with no past history of hypertension, presented with a 2-day history of bitemporal headaches and a sudden onset of left-sided weakness 4 days after ingestion of an over-the-counter medication for back pain, possibly an NSAID. And he was afebrile, drowsy, disoriented, and dysarthric with a blood pressure of 270 by 170. So the neurological examination revealed mild left facial weakness and with a power of grade 4 out of 5 in the left upper and lower limbs. Deep tendon reflexes were brisk, and he demonstrated bilateral extensive plantar responses. fundoscopy revealed grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy changes. This was the fundus photograph, which shows bilateral papilledema incompatible with hypertensive retinopathy. And an initial CT scan again showed a low attenuation abnormalities in the brain stem, white matter of both cerebral hemispheres consistent with cerebral edema. Again, there's no clear-cut images or clear-cut lesions to be identified by a general physician on admission. Subsequently, a hypertensive brainstem encephalopathy was the diagnosis made by the treating clinician and requested an MRI brain again. And the FLAIR sequence of the MRI brain image revealed asymmetrical hyperintensities within the brainstem, dentate nuclei, inferior cerebral peduncles, and white matter of the cerebrum. Diffusion weighted imaging was normal, indicating the absence of infarction, and there was no enhancement with the administration of gadolinium contrast. So this was the MRI image of the patient. Areas of increased signal were present in the pons, white thalamus, and cerebellum in brain MRI fluid attenuated version recovery, and T2A images without any accompanying occipital lobe changes. The treatment with intravenous labetalol was commenced to achieve a normal blood pressure. The serum creatinine was 188 micromole, indicating a renal dysfunction. ECG was again compatible with left ventricular hypertrophy. A 24-hour urinary protein estimation was done since the urine spot test was positive for protein, which revealed 3.4 grams of proteinuria for over 24 hours. Ultrasound and Doppler studies of the kidney were unremarkable, and urinary metanephrine, no metanephrine, and VMA levels were within normal ranges, excluding a possible pheochromocytoma. The last case scenario, the third scenario, a 19-year-old shop assistant in a 38 week of pregnancy was admitted to the emergency room. She had a generalized seizure prior to the admission. Her blood pressure was 170 by 110, and she had diffuse edema and proteinuria. Her blood pressure during the last antenatal visit a week ago was 125 by 70. And this is a typical presentation of eclampsia. So the provisional diagnosis of eclampsia was made and a cesarean section was performed. A CT scan of the brain just after delivery disclosed diffuse white matter edema with occipital prevalence. The patient was treated with a loading dose of 4 gram magnesium sulfate. An infusion of 1 gram per hour was commenced. Blood pressure was controlled with, again, labetalol infusion. Full recovery ensued without complication, and after 4 days, the patient was transferred to the postnatal ward and shortly after discharge with the normal repeat CT brain. This was the CT scan of that eclamptic woman, again showing hypoattenuation mainly in the occipital region. It's very difficult to appreciate on a non-contrast CT brain. So these all three case scenarios are associated with elevated blood pressure, fairly high blood pressure levels, and all three patients were presenting with altered sensorium, and all of them had focal neurological symptoms or signs. So whenever a patient coming with this clinical syndrome, those are the three main syndromes or distinct clinical syndromes I'm talking about. One is a progressive reversible encephalopathy syndrome or PRESS. Number 2 was a brainstem encephalopathy. And number 3 is eclampsia. Those are the 3 recognized syndromes of hypertensive encephalopathy. But there are patients who can overlap with each other. So we'll have a look at the pathophysiology of hypertensive encephalopathy. Usually the cerebral blood flow is maintained. by a delicate balance of vasoconstriction and vasodilatation of the peripheral vessels on the cerebral vessels. Whenever the mean arterial pressure exceeds 120, then the cerebral hyperperfusion occurs, and then there is an autoregulation failure happens, which is most commonly observed in the occipital lobe, because those vessels are poorly supported. So there is always, the occipital lobe is more prone to get autoregulation failure. That's why the images, all the images showing that cerebral edema of the occipital lobe rather than the other lobes. In a patient with known hypertension, usually the biostat of cerebral perfusion was shifted to right. So these patients can withstand very high blood pressure levels. We can observe this with the patients with chronic kidney disease, even with blood pressure of 230 and by 120, they don't develop hypertensive encephalopathy because their biostat is shifted to right. So this slide shows us a blood-brain barrier where the endothelium and astrocyte glial cells come in contact with each other, forming a tight junction. So the hypertensive emergency and hyperperfusion always disrupt this blood-brain barrier and end up in vasogenic edema. The opposite also can happen. Hypoperfusion or any cytotoxin related to the endothelium can result in leakage of fluid and vasogenic edema. So there are so many causes for cerebral edema and disruption in autoregulation. When you take up the pathology of PRESS, there are a number of reasons that can result in PRESS, but the main reason is hypertension, and it can be observed in autoimmune disorders, steroids therapy, cytotoxic drugs. The mechanisms are slightly different. In hyperperfusion, causing disruption of tight junction, but in hypoperfusion with microabscess formation and the neuronal loss and neurotransmitter imbalance were observed in various other mechanisms. So the pathophysiology of PRESS is multiple, but hypertension contributes a significant proportion of patients. So normal cerebral perfusion pressure is usually 50 to 150 millimeter mercury. Mean arterial pressure is 60 to 160 millimeter mercury. And so the intracranial pressure is around 10 to 15. So the cerebral perfusion pressure is maintained by the mean arterial pressure minus the intracranial pressure. So when the MAC increases, cerebral arterial vasoconstriction occurs. When the MAC reduces, cerebral arterial dilatation occurs. So with both will keep the CPP constant. So intracerebral elevated blood pressure causes a breach in the blood-brain barrier. Vascular fluid diffuses across the capillary membrane of the brain parenchyma, and that leads to development of cerebral edema, increased intracranial pressure, and neurological deficits such as altered mentation, visual deficits, and seizures. So that's the basic mechanism of hypertensive encephalopathy. So what are the essentials to diagnose hypertensive encephalopathy? When will you suspect hypertensive encephalopathy? When a patient presents with gradual onset of headache, nausea, vomiting. You have to note that gradual onset of headache, nausea, vomiting, because most of the stroke patients, they present with acute onset of headache, nausea, and vomiting. And usually encephalopathy followed by non-localizing neurological symptoms, such as restlessness, confusion, seizures, and potentially coma. The hypertension is treated promptly, the symptoms of encephalopathy are usually reversible. So on history and examination, with suspected patients with elevated blood pressure, an altered mental state, visual disturbance, and headache or seizures, the following points should be noted. A thorough drug history is essential for identifying any previously used antihypertensive drugs, because a patient who's a known hypertensive are more likely to develop encephalopathy than a non-diagnosed hypertensive patient. And typically, in chronically uncontrolled hypertension, and may have discontinued their antihypertensive medications recently, that is another category of patient, or in rapidly developing and intermittent episodes of hypertension are also more at the risk of developing hypertensive encephalopathy, like in eclampsia. In the majority of the patients, the blood pressure exceeds 220 by 120. That is, they have accelerated hypertension or malignant hypertension. Therefore, should be evaluated for signs of other organ damage that can be found during a hypertensive emergency. Precordial auscultation may reveal signs of reflective of cardiac dysfunction, such as adult heart sound or third heart sound, pulmonary edema with crepitations heard over the lung bases, or fundoscopy may show retinal hemorrhages and papillary edema, which is a sign of a severe hypertensive retinopathy. A complete neurological exam can identify whether a focal or non-focal deficit. So the diagnosis is made with severely elevated blood pressure plus a neurological symptoms by ruling out other conditions that may cause similar symptoms. Ischemic stroke and intracerebral hemorrhage must be excluded in these patients. Those are the most important differential diagnoses. And these conditions are treated totally differently and are not managed primarily or exclusively by lowering the blood pressure. So what are the differential diagnoses of hypertensive encephalopathy, which include, as I said, ischemic stroke, intracerebral hemorrhage, intracranial tumor, occult brain trauma, acute toxic metabolic encephalopathy, particularly due to substance abuse, and cerebral venous thrombosis? Those are the important differential diagnoses. So since these are the differential diagnosis, obviously neuroimaging is the key to differentiate these BDs. So CT brain or MRI scan should be performed to identify brain lesions responsible for neurological signs. To exclude conditions such as ischemic stroke or intracerebral hemorrhage, CT brain is usually more readily available and takes less time to perform. However, CT may not be sensitive as MRI in identifying regions of the brain edema. And CT brain is essential in ruling out some intracranial lesions. This is a very basic concept in MRI. And the three images I have put, T1 weighted, T2 weighted, and flare. T1 and T2 weighted images can be easily differentiated by looking at the CSF. CSF is dark on T1 weighted imaging and bright on T2 weighted imaging. Fluid attenuated inversion recovery flare sequence is similar to T2 weighted image. Here the abnormalities remain bright, but normal CSF fluid is attenuated and made dark. So this sequence is very sensitive to pathology and makes the differentiation between CSF and an abnormality much easier. So when you suspect hypertensive encephalopathy, always request a T2 weighted images or flare images. T2 weighted MRI can localize regions of cerebral edema found with hypertensive encephalopathy, which can then be categorized further as posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome PRESS, as in case scenario 1. Or hypertensive brainstem encephalopathy, as in case scenario 2. Bilateral white matter edema in the posterior cerebral hemispheres is characteristic of PRESS. The distribution of cerebral edema is localized, particularly to the parieto-occipital regions in PRESS and the pontine region in cases of hypertensive brainstem encephalopathy. So what is the role of CSF analysis in hypertensive encephalopathy? Lumbar puncture is not required for the diagnosis of hypertensive encephalopathy, and it may be performed when a patient is being evaluated for encephalopathy to determine etiology. In PRESS, there may be modestly elevated protein level without pleocytosis, that is albumin cytological dissociation, as observed with other conditions. In the meantime, we have to look for other acute HMODs, that is hypertension-mediated organ damages. The common three hypertensive mediated organ damages are heart failure, acute kidney injury, and retinopathy. So other investigations should be performed are ECG, chest X-ray, urine analysis, troponin to rule out acute coronary syndrome, serum electrolyte, serum creatinine. In female patients of childbearing age, do HCG level to rule out pregnancy, and toxicological screening assays, particularly if you suspect a sympathomimetic abuse. So how are we going to manage hypertensive encephalopathy? The initial aim of treatment in patients with moderate to severe hypertensive encephalopathy is to rapidly lower the mean arterial pressure by approximately 10 to 15% in the first hour. No more than 25% compared with the baseline by the end of the first day. So this we should keep in mind. More aggressive hypotensive therapy is both necessary and may lead to ischemic events like stroke or acute coronary syndrome. So you have to switch to oral therapy and achieve the target of systolic BP of 130 and diastolic BP of 80 over 2 to 3 months. The initial reduction of blood pressure is often associated with a modest worsening of kidney function. Again, the kidney is adapted to hyperperfusion. So this change is transient as the vascular disease tends to resolve and the renal perfusion improves over 1 to 3 months. Again, the same phenomena is observed in patients when you initiate on ACE inhibitors and ARBs, and it is more pronounced in patients with renal artery stenosis. So in a summary of management, the immediate reduction of blood pressure is maximum 20 to 25%. The first line treatment available is labetalol or nicardipine. I hope labetalol is more widely used in Sri Lanka than nicardipine. An alternative is sodium nitroprusside. So this chart comprises the common drugs that can be used in encephalopathy: nitroglycerin, labetalol hydrochloride, sodium nitroprusside, nicardipine, and hydralazine. Labetalol and hydralazine are the preferred drugs in eclampsia. And in encephalopathies, usually labetalol and nicardipine is preferred than nitroglycerin. So what is the prognosis of hypertensive encephalopathy? In most cases, hypertensive encephalopathy can be reversed with a prompt but conservative lowering of the blood pressure. The prognosis for this condition can vary depending on whether other comorbidities are present or not. Once patients are released from the hospital, continued vigilance in hypertension management is necessary. So these patients are at risk for other hypertensive crises if they become non-compliant with their medications in the future. What are the complications that can occur if an untreated hypertensive encephalopathy? So failure or late treatment of hypertensive emergency can result in renal failure, retinopathy, myocardial infarction, and stroke. Without prompt treatment, brain edema can progress and lead to status epilepticus, coma, or death. An aggressive treatment of hypertension is not advised and can lead to ischemic conditions in target organs, especially in patients that have an adapted autoregulatory mechanism due to chronic high blood pressure levels. So the clinical pearls or the take-home message: the symptoms of hypertensive encephalopathy are insidious as opposed to stroke. Headache, nausea, and vomiting gradually worsen with time and are followed by non-localizing neurological symptoms. This is in contrast to the abrupt and focal neurological symptoms found with ischemic stroke or intracerebral hemorrhage. CT is not sensitive enough, but to exclude other causes of altered mental state, it can be performed. Avoid an over-aggressive lowering of blood pressure, as it may result in ischemic organ damage. And it should not be lowered any more than 25% of the baseline blood pressure within the first day of treatment. The most common first choice of antihypertensive drug for this condition is labetalol or nicardipine. Finally, I would like to do PME part or MCQ based on the presentation. A 65-year-old male presents to the emergency department complaining of generalized weakness, has a past medical history of hypertension treated with hydrochlorothiazide, lisinopril, and amlodipine. His heart rate is 87 beats per minute, blood pressure 240 by 150. The temperature is 37 degrees Celsius, respiratory rate is 12, SpO2 is normal, around 95. Physical exam reveals bilateral horizontal nystagmus with no other physical exam findings, including no focal neurological deficits. Labs are unremarkable, the non-contrast head CT is negative for pathology. What is the next best step in the management of this patient? First, to reduce the systolic blood pressure to 175 in the first hour. Second, lower the mean arterial pressure by 10 to 15% in first hour, or reduce the diastolic blood pressure to 80 to 90 in the first hour, or the lower the mean arterial pressure by 35% first hour. So it's again virtually a hypertensive emergency. The answer, I think you know that lower the mean arterial pressure by 10 to 15% in the first hour, and the others, the two drastic drop will be deleterious for the patient. That concludes my brief talk. Thank you. Thank you very much for your patient listening. Thank you.